Welcome to this demonstration to show how to configure ODBC connections for use by App Connect Enterprise on Unix and Linux. There are two configuration files needed for this, ODBCINT.ini and ODBC.ini. So we'll have a look at those files first. App Connect Enterprise provides template files for ODBC.ini and ODBCINT.ini, and these can be found in your installation directory in the server ODBC Unix ODBC directory. We recommend that you don't alter these files and that you copy these two files to a location where you can make changes, thus ensuring you always have the original template file should you need to go back to it. So I've created a empty directory where I'm going to keep my ODBC configuration files. So the first step I'm going to do, as I said, is to copy them from my installation to my local directory where we can edit them and look at them without fear of destroying the original files. First of all, we'll look at the ODBCINT.ini file. This is quite a small file and really is only used for turning ODBC trace on and off. We set trace equal to yes to turn it on and replace the text in the angle brackets with a directory where you've got plenty of space for outputting ODBC trace files, as they can potentially get quite large. The other file is ODBC.ini. This file is in three parts. The first part is a simple list of data source names and the name of the driver they're going to use. It's not used, that part is not used in any way for the connections. It's just there as an informal index for people reading the file. So you can fill this part in or you can leave it unfilled. It's not a problem. The next section is a list of individual stanzas for each sort of database. So in the template file, you'll see, like for this DB2 one, we have a template, and in between the angle braces are parts that you will need to change yourself to match your setup. So, for example, on an Oracle one here, you're going to need to give it machine name, the host name, and the service name. You'll also want to change the parts in the square brackets here, which is the name that the data source is going to be referred to, the data source name. So these are the names that will need to match up with what you have on things like your database node in your message flow. We use these names as our internal reference rather than the actual parts and names of the databases. The final section at the very bottom of the file is a bit that must be filled in. It only contains one part you need to change. That is, you need to put in where you've actually installed your copy of ACE. Sometimes you may need to change things like the app code page and the Unicode for your database, but for this demonstration, we won't be needing to do that. So what we're going to do now is we're going to change our ODBCINI file, and we're going to set up a data source name configuration for an Oracle database, a Sybase database, a DB2 database, and an SQL Server database. So as we're already at the bottom of the file, I'm going to fill in my mandatory section first. So I'm going to replace the text in the angle braces with the location where I have installed my copy of ACE. And for me, that is here. So there we go. It's a path to where the drivers are installed, not the driver themselves in this case. So we'll go back to the top, and what we'll do is, to make things a little less cluttered, I'm going to remove all the stanzas that we're not going to use today. So we're just going to keep a DB2 stanza, an Oracle stanza. There are different stanzas in here for different ways of setting up things like Oracle and Oracle with SSL. Keep a Sybase stanza. And we will keep an SQL Server stanza. Let's remove that one. And as we're not going to cover the other databases, we'll remove those as well. But the process is the same. You fill in the parts between the angle brackets with the information that pertains to your system. So now we have a bit clearer. So first of all, we're going to edit our stanza for DB2. So my database on DB2 is actually called UserDB. And in this instance, I'm actually going to call the data source name for it to be the same as well. So I change my data source name in the angle brackets and my database name to that. So DB2 is different to the other databases we work with. We use the DB2 supplied ODBC driver rather than drivers from DataDirect. So in this case, you'll need to know where your DB2 libraries are installed and replace the text in the angle brackets with the location of your DB2 installation. So my DB2 installation will be in here. So let's just replace that. So that's where I have DB2 installed on my system. So that's all you need to do for DB2. It's quite a small stanza, not a lot to change in there. Next, we'll create a stanza for an Oracle database. Again, we have to replace this with our installation path. So there we go. And that then tells the driver that this is where my Oracle driver is located. And we will need to give it a host name. So it's the machine where your Oracle database is installed. In my case, that'll be that machine. You'll then need to give it the port number that it's listening on the machine. So my port number and the name of the Oracle service you've defined. And that's my Oracle service. It's very similar to Sybase. Again, we have to put in our path, our ACE path. So we'll just quickly do that. And then for Sybase, you'll need your database name. My Sybase database is actually also called UserDB, but we can't have more than one data source name in the ODBCINI file that is the same. So I'm going to call mine SciviewDB. So if I was using a compute node, I would have to call it SciviewDB, not UserDB. And as I've just noticed, I haven't changed the Oracle one, and we'll call that one HorrorUDB, just to keep the naming going the same. So again, if I was accessing Oracle in my message flow, that's the name that I would use, RUDB, not the name of the host or the service name or the database as it is on Sybase. And the final part for Sybase one is to tell it which machine it's listening on and where you can find the port. So for my machine, that's port 4100 on that machine there. Again, the process SQL server, very much the same. Again, we have to change the template to give it the actual install directory for our ACE installation this time round. And here again, my database name in my SQL Server database is also UserDB. Again, we're going to rename it and we're going to use the data source name internally, so we are going to call this one SQLUDB. Just make those all the same. Right, and again, I need my host in here. So the host names can be your proper host name, like a machine name. They can also be just an IP address. So we'll do one with an IP address here just to make things a little bit different. And my port number for SQL Server. So if we go back to the top of the file, as I said, you can choose to fill this section in or not. What I'll do is I'll fill it in for some for using for DB2, for Oracle, Sybase. And what I'll do is I won't fill the SQL Server one in just to show you that it doesn't really matter whether you fill that section in or not. So this is our ODBCINI file now. All the angle brackets have been replaced and we should now be able to use this as to make our connections from ACE to our databases. So ACE needs to know where to find your ODBCINI file and your ODBCSysINI file. And we do this with a couple of environment variables which must be set before you start your server. The first is ODBCINI. This points to the file ODBCINI, like so. And the second one is ODBCSys.ini. Now this doesn't point to a file, it points to the directory where the ODBCSysINI file, ODBCInst.ini as it's called, where that file is. We don't have any choice over that. That's how Unix ODBC works. So that's what you've got to set. And you can always check you've got them right. You could just catch your value of ODBCINI just to make sure you've typed it correctly and you're getting the ODBCINI file you expect. So let's create ourselves a broker, just a very basic broker. We'll call it ODBC video because that's what we're doing. There we go. Now you'll need to tell ACE the user ID password that you're going to use to connect to your data source. We do this with NQSI set DB palms. So we'll set them up for each of our databases. I've kept the same user ID and password across all the databases. The only thing you'll see change on each command is the name of the data source name, and that needs to match the data source names that were given for each of our stanzas in the ODBCINI. So let's set up the DB2 one. And one for Oracle, one for Sybase, and one for SQL Server. So once we've done this, we can test the connections then by using the NQSI CVP command. You don't actually need to start a broker. This will just run through and make a connection to your database and report back various information pieces about your database, like what data types it supports, what driver it used, the name of the database, and general information like that. Obviously, if it fails, you might have got your password wrong. It'll flag that up for you so you can deal with those before you start running your broker. Let's have a go at a CVP command for DB2. So it's not very long. It really just takes an argument of the name of the database that you're going to try to get to. There we go. So we've connected to the DB2 database. You can see its version of the database, your instance, your data source name, the name of the user we used, what we called it, our data source name, which in the case of the DB2 one happens to be the same as the database, and what various things it supports. So having done that for DB2, let's just check that we got all the others correct. So we'll now look at our Oracle one, and you'll see a very similar sort of report telling us which database we connected to, data source we connected to, things like the useful things like the version of the ODBC driver, which machine it was on, the name of the driver. And we'll just make sure the others work. So we'll do the Sybase one next. Again, same sort of information, driver names, driver versions, names of the databases that you connected to. And finally, let's just test out our SQL Server one. And there we go, there's the SQL Server one, same sort of information, everything you need to know, and all the things that ACE will interrogate the database for when it makes its own connection. So hopefully you can see it's fairly straightforward to make an ODBC connection from ACE to your chosen database. You just need to set up your ODBCINI file, reference it with some environment variables before you start your ACE integration server. And then you can either use CVP to test your commands, or you can wait at your connections, or you can wait until you run your message flow, and the same checks that CVP makes will be made when ACE makes a connection. Thank you for listening.